Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. This is Open Line first Monday, or I suppose it might be first Tuesday in Europe and other places around the world that are watching this program. This is our unique episode of the month in which I bring back a former Journey Home guest, but we dedicate most of the program to your phone calls and emails. And so you, particularly tonight, are an essential part of tonight's program. Our guest tonight is someone you'll recognize, I hope. Alex Jones is a Pentecostal pastor, convert to the Catholic Church. You actually were on the Journey Home program not all that long off after you came into the church, right?
About 6 months.
It was really, really soon.
Yes.
And you've been in the church now a couple years, 3 years or so?
3.5 years.
Okay. Now, right off the bat, though, I want to give you the phone numbers because we're anxious to hear your questions for Alex Jones. 1-800-221-9460. Outside North America, you can give us a call at 205-271-2980. And we especially send out a special message to, who were you with recently?
Father Urban Hudlin in Trinidad.
And you had a nice...
And Tobago. Had a fantastic trip there. Wonderful host. We preached in about six parishes, overflowing, filled.
Oh, great.
It was a wonderful time. And he's a very dedicated priest.
I know you mentioned that there are a few people down there that have seen EWTN and the Journey Home program, so we extend our greeting to you, and I'm giving the phone numbers again, so you can give a call to Alex, 1-800-221-9460, outside North America, 205-271-2980, and you can send me an email at journeyhome@ewtn.com. Alex, it's great to have you back to the Journey Home.
It's good to be back.
Extend a hand of fellowship to my guests. I know it's hard to condense the whole story into the short time we have, and for the audience that didn't hear your story before, you can get the old Journey Home program interview with you. Your conversion story is also available on cassette tape. Give us a quick summary, though, of your journey into the church.
How quick? 5 minutes? In 1999, pursuing a Bible study, I've been a pastor for 25 years, Pentecostal evangelical pastor, and loved it. Had a great time. 1998, in preparation for a Bible study on 1 Timothy chapter 2, I wanted to go back and discover apostolic worship. And then going back and getting the information, researching the information, I discovered that the church was hierarchic, it was Eucharistic centered, and it was liturgical as well as charismatic. And that launched me on a search to learn the faith and to see exactly what the church was like and how it evolved over the ages. One very important principle I learned, that the church evolved, that it grew. It grew in its understanding of its revelation, and it grew in its understanding of itself. And so what I discovered at the beginning of apostolic Christianity and where the church is today, we see a big growth. In fact, the Lord said himself, the kingdom of God is like a little mustard seed that's planted in the ground, and then it grows to be a big tree that allows birds to come in to find shelter. So I learned this, and then I began the process of conversion. Took about a year and a half. I shared it with my congregation. Many did not agree. Some did. And in the process, about 54 members came into the church with me, including 14 members of my own family.
That's just amazing. It was always amazing, your story, because I've interviewed many people on this program, and in our work in the Coming Home Network, we're always dealing with clergy converts, but it's not often that when they come in that they're able to bring in people with their former parishioners with them. Sadly, sometimes from the time they realize what they have to do, once the word gets out, they're out of the pulpit.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm like this. I'm a shepherd. Well, I was a shepherd.
You're still a shepherd.
Okay. Thank you,
in
Marcus.
A different position.
Okay. But as a shepherd, I discovered a green pasture, and in all good conscience, I couldn't just walk away. Well, I could have, but not with a good conscience. I wanted to share my faith, what I'd learned. This is the church of the New Testament. This is the church that gave us the New Testament, and I wanted to share it with them. So I just couldn't just walk away. I asked them to give me the opportunity of sharing what I'd learned with them, to give me 6 months, which they did. And I pulled down the screen and I began to teach, and I taught about Mary, and I taught about apostolic ministry, and I taught about Mary, and I taught about purgatory, and I taught about Mary. Yeah. We had a problem with Mary.
Yeah. Right, right.
But I just couldn't walk away and leave my, they were sheep. I had led many of them to Christ. I had seen, saw their lives change, you know, and I wanted to give them the opportunity to make the decision. If they decided not to come, then I would more or less help them find another pastor, because there's God's people too. But I had to go with what I knew and what I understood. For me not to have come into the church would have been a great, great sin.
Yeah. The reason I had mentioned that earlier was that I had a guest about a month ago who wanted to do the same thing. In fact, he went to his, it wasn't called a bishop, but his leader above him in his denomination, saying that very thing. You know, this is what I plan to do. What I'd like is about 6 months or 6 weeks to at least tell the people so they're not confused. He was gone.
Yeah.
And not only gone, the person above him had turned the whole congregation against him, and he was excommunicated from their denomination. So sometimes they don't have that opportunity.
Well, being an independent church, I had that
you had the great
opportunity
to do
that.
Now, I was mentioned to you earlier that I felt that I'd let you off the hook earlier that first time you were on my program. I mean, I let you tell your story, and then I gave the opportunity to preach. Well, nothing is easier for you than preaching the gospel. So I wanted to make it a little more challenging for you this time.
All right.
Now, my staff in the Coming Home Network deal with clergy on the journey all the time. Jim Anderson, the man on our staff that does the most contact with Protestant clergy, deals with 2 to 3 brand new Protestant clergy every week. The most common thing he often hears is they say that when they're on their journey into the church and they go to the local diocese, they go to the local parish, too often they're told that since Vatican II, you don't have to convert, that the church isn't about conversion anymore. They ought to just stay where they are. Don't mess up your lives, stay where they are. Well, given all that message which is out there, mm-hmm. right or wrong, you have the audacity to be what? The director of evangelization for your diocese?
Evangelization coordinator for the Archdiocese of Detroit.
Well, if we're not to reach out and bring anyone into the church, well, then you must just sit around all day doing coffee.
I wish. No.
What is evangelization then?
Evangelization.
Well, first of all, is that right? These guys have
been
told?
There are some that feel that way, yes. Unfortunately, I've run into some of them, and they feel that evangelization is something that just should not be done. It's very difficult to do that and with people who feel that we're okay, you're okay, I'm okay, they're okay, everybody's going to heaven, everything's going to be okay, you know. Huh. Instead of really getting into the gospel message, Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor and to bring prisoners freedom. So the gospel is relevant in every age. Today's society, even more, it is relevant because there are bondages. There are prisons that people live in today that only the gospel can free them. And so the gospel of Jesus Christ must be preached. It must be shared. It must first be lived out in the life of the faithful. And then it must be proclaimed with the mouth, proclaimed to those who need to hear a message of hope, need to hear a message of love, whose lives have been destroyed. They know that there's a God that loves them. So the church says, this is the very purpose for our existence. And John Paul II in the Mission of the Redeemer teaches that this is the very heart of the church, is to reach out into our society, to our culture, and to bring the kingdom of God, and to bring the gospel of life. Yeah. So this is what we're all about in evangelization. Yeah. It's first taking the gospel, applying it to our lives in the church, bringing ourselves to another conversion, because our Christian journey is a series of conversions, being converted in our hearts, and enjoying a greater fellowship, a greater love of Jesus Christ, and then taking that out into the community, and taking that out to where we work, where we recreate, and sharing the gospel. That's what the church is trying to do in the 21st century. This is the new evangelization. This is the springtime of Christianity, spoken of by John Paul II.
Yep. You know, you were committed to Scripture, knew Scripture well. Let me ask you, I'm going to give you a test here to see if you
test
get this word. Right. Which of this is the correct wording of the Great Commission? A, go ye therefore and make committees. B, go ye therefore and make comfortable dwellings for thyself. 3, go ye therefore and don't make waves. Or 4, go ye therefore and make disciples.
I think the last one is the one, the correct one, my friend.
But why would I have the audacity to ask that? Because people, the misunderstanding.
Well, because in today's comfortable society, there's a tendency to float, to be apathetic, and to enjoy the goodness of the Lord. But the commission, the Great Commission of Jesus Christ, is as relevant today as it was in the first century. Go, the Lord says. Go, it tells us in the church. Go, and not just be comfortable with our comfortable, beautiful churches, but taking this gospel out, because God loves humanity. He's madly in love with humanity, and He wants all men to be saved. But how can they hear without a preacher? And how can they preach except they be sent? And so we all are sent. We all are part of the priesthood of Jesus Christ and the universal priesthood. And therefore, we're to take the kingdom of God into every aspect of our domestic lives and our public lives.
I'm glad you mentioned that whole verse from Romans, because that important part of being sent is so key, isn't it? I mean, to make sure that you're preaching the right gospel. In fact, let me ask you this question, then we'll go to our first caller. I imagine there's a few out there who maybe knew you before, and a lot of them, coming from where they come from, don't have a very high view of the Catholic Church. They might even have a few choice words to use for it that I won't mention here. But they might, a lot of them think that there's some place way back in history that the church, Catholic Church, got off base, got skewed, got taken off. And all these different groups have a different starting point for that skewedness. In fact, some might even go back to Galatians 1 and say it's right there when Paul said, "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you in the grace of Christ and turning to a different gospel." And they would say, "See, already." Or maybe they say, actually, it sounds like this verse from that book you mentioned in 1 Timothy, when Paul says, "Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times some will depart from the faith by giving heed to deceitful spirits and doctrines of demons through the pretensions of liars whose consciences are seared, who forbid marriage and enjoin abstinence from food which God created to be received with thanksgiving." Sounds like the Catholic Church. What do you say to them? What proof do you give that you're not just following another gospel?
Good question. Unfortunately, I preached that myself. I'm guilty. I preached that at one time. But I came to understand this. The church that Jesus Christ founded in the upper room, He gave two gifts. The gift of perpetuity, in other words, it would never go out of existence. The devil would drown it. He tried to burn it. He tried to enslave it and to beat it, but it grew. Tertullian said, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the faith of the church. He gave it perpetuity, that it would never go out of existence. And number two, He gave it the gift of incorruptibility. John 16:13, "I will send the Paraclete to you, and He will be with you forever, and He will lead you into all truth." Now, with these two promises, if you look at the church in the upper room, that church had the gift of perpetuity, it had the gift of incorruptibility. So that meant that that church would go through human history and would end up at the shores of the celestial shores of heaven and to be deliver the faithful to Jesus Christ. That church would never get off base. That church would never become corrupted. That church would never fail. That church would never sink. And I'm preaching now. Okay. Now, all we need to do is just to go back to the upper room and discover what church was that. Because that church would have an unbroken history from Jesus to Jesus, from the upper room to the second coming. It would have an unbroken history. Now, what church does that? Well, it wasn't mine. It started mine in 1982, so it doesn't qualify. And we look at the different other churches. We find that each had a human originator. And I'm not being critical. But I'm just saying, it's a statement of historical fact. Each one had a human originator, and with good men, good holy men. We're not discussing that. But they had a starting point in time subsequent to the upper room. But if you go back to the upper room and say, what church did he establish, and follow the history of that church, you find that that church was called Catholic in 110 AD by Ignatius, and that it's since had been called Catholic all the way into the present day.
Very good.
So I'm in the church of the New Testament.
All right.
I'm in the church of Jesus Christ.
All right, very good. what I'm going to do rather than run with that. We've got a caller already. In fact, all these were good ways of priming the pump for our callers, because I want them to have their shot at you as soon as they can. All right. Good. Let's take our first caller tonight. Let's see. This is it Ginger? Ginger from Ohio. Hello, Ginger. What's your question for us tonight?
Hi, Marcus. I love your show. And actually, Alex Jones may have answered my question, but is there anything other than the history of the church that might strike a Pentecostal heart to convert? My daughter has fallen away from the church. She's presently dating a fellow I have yet to meet. And if we ever get around to talking religion, which apparently he's kind of a deep person, likes to argue, what sort of things could I present to him that might be a little bit persuasive? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ginger.
Ginger, number one, be thankful that, was it her husband or her brother or son that...
Her daughter's dating a Pentecostal.
Okay. Rejoice that they are converted to Jesus Christ. We sometimes overlook that because they're not with us. Then we fail to rejoice and to recognize that God's grace is in action. Rejoice that they are converted to Jesus Christ. And then number two, know your faith. Know how to defend your faith, because Pentecostals have 10,000 questions they want to ask. Be prepared. The Bible says, be prepared to answer every man the reason of the hope that lies within you. Know first Scripture. Secondly, know what the church teaches. And then thirdly, love them where they are. Let them see that you have gone through a conversion, and that love in your heart will attract them, and they will ask you questions, and you're knowing the faith, you'll be able to share and help them. But converting them, that's God's work. That's not our work.
Yeah. It's sometimes our arguments, our apologetic arguments can open the door, but we can't really argue anybody into the kingdom. It's the work of grace.
We belong to God. And our hearts are made for him, and they're restless until they rest in him. Therefore, he, through the power of the Holy Spirit, is the one that brings conversion. We just are workers with God.
All right, very good. Let's take our first email tonight. This comes from Nora. I am interested in becoming Catholic, but as a Protestant, I believe I am going to heaven. I know Jesus and the Holy Spirit, this should be enough. Why don't Catholics believe they are going to heaven? To me, this would not be uplifting. Why we can't work for salvation? She's got a number of things in there. But I think you've known kind of where she's coming from. She's Protestant, believes that I've got Jesus, I've got the Holy Spirit. Why isn't this enough? And then the other issue is she doesn't see Catholics that feel assured of their salvation.
That's a good question. My conversion was not based on finding Jesus. I had Jesus. I knew Jesus. I lived with Jesus. I prayed to Jesus. I was pretty much sure that unless I did something really major wrong, that heaven was my home. And I think the average Christian is that way. We don't have absolute certainty because we're not at the end of our days. Anything could happen. Now, I'm 63 years of age, and I've seen a lot of things happen that I thought would never happen. So you can't say with such a surety, I know I'm going to heaven. Well, maybe at that moment you might be, but the Catholic is taught to look at life in its total spectrum, and that as you go, we have been saved, we are being saved, and we will be saved. But it's a process that we're going through. And therefore, we like to say, well, I think I'm going to heaven. I'm pretty much sure of it. But I haven't made the last breath yet. I haven't come to the end of the journey. And life sometimes has a funny way of throwing curves at you.
Maybe just one last comment on her.
Sure.
Her last line, we can't work for our salvation. I think the point there just maybe clarifies. She may not totally understand what Catholics understand about being sure of their salvation.
Well, let me say it very clearly. The Catholic Church teaches we're saved by grace through faith. Bottom line, it teaches that. And I've run into many people who say, well, you Catholics believe that you go to heaven by working good works. And I have to correct them. I said, no, we don't believe that and we don't teach that. We teach we are saved by grace. Through faith, our faith, bottom line. But we also say this, faith without works is absolutely positively dead. The Bible says in Philippians chapter number 2, around verse number 12, see, I haven't forgotten my Protestant ways, to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. We receive it. We receive the life of God. We receive that divine spark in our hearts and our souls. Now we have to let it work itself out in our daily lives.
All right, thank you. Let's take our next caller from Bernadette, Wisconsin. Hello, Bernadette. What's your question?
Hi. I'm from Wisconsin, the home of the Green Bay Packers.
That's right.
Four and four now. But anyway, when you go to confession and you are sincere and the Catholic priest absolves you of those sins, we know that Jesus Christ will forget about those sins. They are not brought up at the time of your particular judgment when you die. But will they ever be brought up for the general judgment at the end of the world?
Thank you, Bernadette.
What's forgiven is forgiven. Positively and absolutely.
Yeah.
It's, I will separate you as far as the east is from the west from your sins. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses thoroughly.
Yeah. Yeah. What's that old, the white is whiter than snow? You know,
yes.
It's interesting, the imagery of red blood making you whiter than snow, that
yes.
imagery from the Old
yes.
Testament. But that is the reality of that. And that's actually, Bernadette, it's good you brought that up, because I can see how some people might wonder that last question, as if he's kind of keeping them in a safe back there and he's going to one last time.
Marcus, if I could just add this. God wants to save us. God doesn't have a book where he's taking down everything we do to condemn us. Of course, he's omnipotent and omniscient. But God really is for us. And God will do whatever he can do to bring us to salvation. And sometimes I think that people feel God is kind of making it difficult for them to get into heaven. He's done as much as he can do in sending his son to die for us. So just keep that in mind. God loves me. And if I ask him to forgive me, he will forgive me. And he will not bring it up again. Of course, unless I don't forgive somebody else.
Yeah, when you think about that, the images in the New Testament where every word, you know, is there in the book. It's not so that God can use this as a cudgel against us, but to drive us to our knees as children to a loving Father so that we are sorry, so that we can turn and come back to him, so they can be put aside again. I mean, that's what he wants to do, is get rid of that stuff.
And I think when he said every word will be written down, he's trying to show the totality of justice, yeah. that this is complete. God knows us thoroughly. He knows every cell and every fiber of our being. And therefore, he's just telling us that justice will be served regardless.
Yeah. Let's, why don't we take a break? And we'll come back with some more of your calls and emails for Alex Jones. See you in a bit. Welcome back. Our guest this evening on this Open Line Monday is Alex Jones. Thanks, Alex, for condensing your journey. And also, once again, I gave you a chance to preach a little bit, you know, making it easy for you. Let's go with our next caller, Rita from New York. Hello, Rita. What's your question tonight?
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to ask Mr. Jones how he feels now. I mean, before he was a pastor, a leader of the flock, and now... I was wondering, I mean, is he going to become a priest, or, you know, what's going on? Because he seems like a great, very powerful, charismatic leader. And also, I believe he's African-American, and my husband is African-American. I would love to see some African-American leadership in the Catholic Church. And to please pray for my husband, because he's a former Pentecostal. He baptized Catholic, went through the whole thing, became a Pentecostal. Now that he's married to me, I kind of force him to go to church. And I think to see someone like Mr. Jones would be excellent. You know?
Yep. Yep. Thank you, Rita. Thank you very, very much for your question. What are you doing now? I mean, have you thought about diaconate, the priesthood, and any of those issues?
Well, now, isn't it ironic you brought that up? I would love to be a priest. If my bishop suggested or hinted even just a little bit that it's the open door possibility, then I would jump at the possibility, because I'm a shepherd at heart and I do enjoy shepherding people. Yeah. Unfortunately, my bishop doesn't want married priests in this diocese, and I have to take that as the will of God. What am I doing now? Next October, I will be ordained a permanent deacon in the Catholic Church. So that's a good thing is happening to me. Secondly, God just opened doors for me. He opened a door of evangelization in the Archdiocese of Detroit. About 2 years ago, they approached me and asked me if I wanted to work with Father Jesse Cox, who was a fantastic Dominican priest, in evangelization. Well, I said yes. And this year, they're taking that once private, or should say special project, and they're using it for the entire archdiocese. And they've asked me to work with this particular archdiocese as the evangelization coordinator. So I have a job, thanks be to God. I have income, thanks be to God. And I do eat well, as you can see.
And you get a chance to speak once in a while.
I get a chance. Well, evangelization is what I'm all about. I'm all about bringing the good news of Jesus Christ into every strata of human life. Because I know what he did for me. I know the power of the Holy Spirit. I know the transforming graces of Jesus Christ. And I know that most people would do better if they knew better. And they don't know, so they can't do better. And so being invited into evangelization in the Archdiocese of Detroit was a wonderful opportunity to share that gift with the church in Detroit and with the people of Detroit.
All right. Let's go with our next caller, then, James from Colorado. Hello, James. What's your question?
Hello, Pastor Grody and Pastor Jones. I'd like to ask Mr. Jones, how does he view the Protestant Reformation now that he's sort of viewed it from both sides of the aisle, or, does he see that the Catholic Church was corrupt in some instances and thus needed reform, or did he think the reformers went too far, or have modern Protestants forgotten that many of the reformers still held at least most of the teachings of the Catholic Church to be true?
All right. Thank you, James. Good question. I'll correct you first. We're no longer pastors, but we were pastors. But thank you for your fine question. So how do you view the Reformation now from this side of the Tiber?
The Church in its long history, 2,000-year history, there are periods of decline where the people within the Church sometime were a little less than enthusiastic about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And during the beginning of the Renaissance, at the Middle Ages, you have perhaps the lowest time in Catholic Church history when there was a lot of perhaps what we might call corruption. But the Church had begun reforming itself. Priests and different movements within the Church had sprung up to bring about reformation. Martin Luther wanted to bring reformation to the Church. He did not want to start a new movement. He simply wanted to correct some of the abuses he felt was abuses in the Church. And it just went a little bit too far. Yes, the Church did have a lot of corruption. People in it were corrupt. But there were also a lot of saintly people, a lot of good people. We tend to forget that the Church in this time had the Francis of Assisi, it had St. Dominic, it had Bonaventure, it had all of these great minds and men. It had monasteries. So the Church wasn't totally corrupt, and that's, I think, an erroneous view of the time. But there was corruption, and I think Martin Luther saw the corruption, and loving the Church and loving what he thought of Christ and God, he wanted to bring about a reform. But in my own personal perspective, it just went too far. It just got out of hand. It became heated. People dug trenches and took positions, and pretty soon fractures took place, and then the Church was divided. And that was, to me now looking back on it, that was an unfortunate time in Church history, very unfortunate, but I understand it. And I understand Martin Luther, and I understand those reformers who really were trying to do what they felt was God's will. But having said that, the church, even though it did have some elements that might have been corrupt, the church is the bride of Christ. It is holy and undefiled. And I think that it was a great damage to the church when these different reformers pulled away. It split the body, and I'm sure it grieved the heart of our Lord. And in these last days, in the last 50 to 100 years, there seems to be a movement back to unity. And I'm praying that in my lifetime that there will be real unity between Catholics and Protestants and Orthodox, that we come again one church.
The caller posed it to me too, so I'm going to add just a little bit, sure, to that too. Just with that, not in any way different than what Alex has said, is that there's another aspect of what was going on before the Reformation, which I think we can learn a lot from, and that is that conversion and authentic walk in faith, is not merely a head issue, and it isn't only a heart issue. It's a both and. It's on the outside as well as the inside. And there are times in the history of the church when people can get caught up in the idea that their faith is primarily expressed on the outside without an internal conversion. And when one looks at history in that time right before the Reformation, the externalization of the faith had truly increased. People were more interested in pilgrimages, in relics, in seeing things, and even buying indulgences for their salvation, even though that's not what the church taught. But they had gotten caught up in these externals without the internal foundation for that external life. They hadn't have internal conversion. And that's one of the reasons why one of the main things all the Protestant reformers focused on was this internal, real conversion, whether it was purely by God's command, like predestined, or whether it was Luther, completely a surrender of faith. They went in that direction. But what the danger that happened to Reformation is that because they had a focus on the externals without the internal conversion, when they focused on the internals, they blamed the externals as distractions from the true conversion. So they threw out the externals as a distraction, leaving only the internal. And you can see that in how quickly the reformers amongst themselves even started fragmenting on trying to define what a true internal conversion was, even to the point where in the 20th century, people have limited the entire faith down to just Jesus in me. Nothing else counts. And so what we recognize is that the importance of the both and, the internal as well as the external aspects of conversion. The physical aspects of the Catholic faith are very important to the expressions of what goes on the inside. I will say that some of the negatives that happened after Vatican II involved the same thing. People whose lives had been too externally focused before the council went through this great conversion, had a great internal conversion, but threw out everything else because it didn't mean much to them. The important was, it's too bad Luther and the other reformers didn't learn the true meaning of the externals so they could have appreciated them as an augmentation and a foundation for their internal conversion.
Well said, Marcus. Okay. Couldn't have said it better.
Okay. I learned it from you, Alex. Let's go to this next email. And this is from Trinidad, Tom, St. Joseph, Trinidad. Hi, Marcus. Just to say that I was really inspired with the zeal of Alex Jones' testimony that he gave at the Larry Gomes Stadium. It proves to me that when one seeks the truth, you will meet Christ and find the Catholic Church. Did Alex have any difficulty with purgatory? Well, he's not there yet.
No, I'm not there yet. No, I had no problems with purgatory. It only made sense. Even evangelicals realize, though they say we're saved by grace, realize that we are sinners and that we come short and that none of us probably, well, most likely will not die perfect. We will die with some kind of ill-advised sin or attachment to sin. Even the most ardent evangelical will say that. Well, there's got to be some type of cleansing from the moment of death to the moment we stand before the Blessed Trinity. It only makes sense. We're not saved by our works, and we're not saved because we're perfect. So God has to more or less the actual sins that we have, the impediments to grace, have to be removed before we come into the presence of the Blessed Trinity. Because after all, we're talking about perfect holiness here. We're talking about perfection, and we're talking about an imperfect person coming before a perfect God, and there has to be some type of adjustment in between. Well, the evangelical might call that time between death and coming before the Blessed Trinity as final sanctification. Catholics call it purgatory.
Yeah. Getting your clothes clean to walk into the marriage feast.
Take your shoes off. You got mud on them.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. Let's take our next caller, Lucianne from Minnesota. Is that right, Lucianne from Minnesota?
Yes, please.
Yes, what's your question?
Yeah, as a Catholic, I was born a Catholic. For the last 34 years of my life, I've been a Catholic. But I find it so difficult going to the sacrament of reconciliation. So I just want to ask him, as a convert coming now into the Catholic Church, what advice can he give people like us who have these difficulties, who have always been there but just kind of neglected?
All right, that's
a good question.
Thank you very much for your question.
Yeah, that's a good question. Initially, I had problems going to confession. After all, you know, as a non-Catholic, if we sin and come short, we just go into our closet and say, you know, forgive me either. But now to come before a man and confess sins was very difficult for me. But I discovered the release in doing that. I discovered that that freed me from sin, from that sin that I had become entangled in, confessing and then sharing with the priest, released me. And everywhere I go, I tell people, there's a power in the sacrament of reconciliation, a power of freeing from sin, and that if we stay away, then sin accrues and grows. If we attend to the sacrament of reconciliation on a regular basis, our lives are being transformed by the hands of God. So I would say go and realize that, number one, you're doing what Christ has wanted you to do, to confess your sins one to another. That's the word of God, confess your sins one to another. And be ye healed one of another. So it may be difficult, yeah, but it's a blessing for you. It's a strength to you.
I was thinking in Scripture that one of the problems is, and from where you come from and I come from, we saw how just a phrase in Scripture like walk by the Spirit can be interpreted in 10 different ways, depending mm-hmm. on how you want to understand it. And one way that I've recognized the value of Paul's call to walk by the Spirit, that there's the mystery of His grace causing us, enabling us to walk by the Spirit, the grace, mm-hmm. and our surrender of our will to walk. There's that mystery of the both and we need that grace, and that's why the sacraments, that's why we need confession. It isn't merely our mind getting changed as we hear the fine words and we release them, but we have that experience of divine life that's touches our soul, which doesn't have emotion, doesn't have the feelings like our body does. So it's hard to tell when it comes in and comes out, right?
We're being formed.
But yes.
We're being formed.
So it's
formed,
essential.
Yes.
Whether we feel it or not, it's happening.
We're being formed.
That's the promise of the church. And so it's so absolutely important. Let's take this next email. Very interesting email. Comes from Mrs. Jan Simmons. I am very happy to see Alex Jones on your program. Being an African-American Catholic, it excites me to see diversity within our church. God bless Mr. Jones and the work God will have him do for our Catholic brothers and sisters. I attend an African-American Catholic church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, but we don't see our culture being utilized in any significant way within the church. Can you comment, or perhaps this has not been your experience?
How much time you got? Enculturation, it's called. And it's a problem. Because many people view enculturation as changing the faith or diluting the faith. But in actuality, unless a culture sees its face in liturgy, then it cannot believe that that liturgy is for them. And so I've been in many churches that have enculturated African-American culture. And those churches are dynamic. Those churches are packed to the ceiling. And I've been in churches where African-Americans, a few, attend with no enculturation, and of course, the church is not as vibrant. I agree with you. The Catholic Church is a unity in diversity. I've been blessed to go to Africa, to go to the islands of the Caribbean, and I've seen different kinds of Catholicism. And it's alive and vibrant. And I only wish that in our country here in America, that many of our churches would allow, especially in African-American communities. We're not talking about Polish communities, and we're not talking about Irish communities. That's their culture. Of course, they have a right to express their culture. But when it comes to African-Americans, we like to worship as a type of celebration. And you know, our music is very special to us. And so I'd like to see more in America of our churches being sensitive to that issue of enculturation. Because I've seen it in Africa, and I've seen it in Trinidad, and I've seen it in several other places. And it's alive. It's dynamic. It ministers to those people.
In fact, I remember experiencing a little bit of it when I was in Rome two times ago when an African congregation was visiting with the Holy Father. And there the Mass had some of that enculturation there because of the Africans that were involved. But the key to people, make sure you don't misunderstand what Alex is saying. You quoted Augustine earlier. But Augustine also makes this comment, in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, diversity.
Absolutely.
In all things, charity. That's what we mean by enculturation. You don't mess with the essentials.
Absolutely.
That's not what you're talking about.
No. Let me give you an example. Most people think that I'm talking about bringing a rock and roll band inside the church and just letting it rip, you know.
Or messing with the liturgy.
The liturgy, you know, and maybe, you know, stand upside down and, you know whatever. I was in Uganda last year, and I went to a healing service in the cathedral in Kampala, about 1,000 people. And let me tell you about Africans. Africans love to sing, and they love to worship. In fact, I have this saying, I came away with this saying, if you want money, come to America. We're a wealthy nation. If you want tradition, go to Rome. It has plenty there. But if you want joyful worship, you go to Africa. And I'm telling you, the singing was just melodious. They had every kind of instrument you could want. They had bongos, congos, gongos, and every other kind of goes. They had electric piano. They had everything. And it was alive. It was, as we say, on jam. Until it came time for the sacrament of the Eucharist. At that moment, 1,000 people in reverence dropped to their knees. You could have heard a pin drop as the African priest intoned the words of institution. I couldn't understand the African language, but I could see with such great diligence how he handled the species, how he took his time to hold it up before the people, how the prayers were said, and how the people responded. So that you have a blending there of African culture, which included dancing. They had African dancers, but that's part of their culture, you know. And so we can blend both as long as the essentials are there, as long as we follow the essentials of the Latin rite, the Latin Mass, we can enculturate any type of culture.
Yeah. Which missionaries from the beginning recognized when they came to England from Rome, they recognized this idea of grace builds on nature. They
yes.
recognized the value of seeing ways to touch a culture with the gospel.
And the Catholic Church enters into culture, takes those things that are harmful to man, sanctifies that culture, and elevates it and puts it as a treasure in its church. That's why it's universal. The church is universal. It ministers to all people. That's why I love it so much.
Let's take our next caller, Pat from North Carolina. Hello, Pat. What's your question?
Hi, Marcus. I look forward to your program every week.
Oh, thank
you. It's a blessing. I wanted to know, I'm in an RCI class at this time, and wanted to know, as two former Protestants that you are and your guest, how did you come to grips with transubstantiation?
All right, Pat. Thank you very much.
God bless you both.
Well, Pat, for me, when I read it in the Fathers, that settled the issue. When I understood that this had been apostolic teaching from the beginning of time, even though it wasn't called transubstantiation, the early church fathers, in fact, Ignatius, who was the second from St. Peter, who actually heard John the Apostle preach, Ignatius of Antioch says that this bread is the flesh of Jesus, not a symbol of Jesus, but the flesh of Jesus, and the cup is the blood of Jesus. Now, this was written about 107 A.D. by a man who had heard and received his teaching from the apostles themselves. Now, they didn't call it transubstantiation then. That's a fancy word that comes from Aristotelian philosophy that was rediscovered back in the late Middle Ages. And subsequently, it was a definition that was applied to something that the churches always believed and held. So I had no problems with it. Once I understood it comes from the apostles, no problem.
Yeah, I remember the person that helped me understand it, it was Scott Hahn, my old seminary friend who helped me in my own journey. He was saying, you know, if we had been walking around Jerusalem and during the time of Jesus, and we saw him come up to us, this dirty Palestinian, you know, and smelly feet, and probably, you know, he would look just like a regular human being. Could we look at him and believe he's the creator of the universe? Our senses would have not been able to believe that. Well, if we can believe that, then why not transubstantiation? Why not the miracle of what God can do? If he can do this, if he can create us, if he can create the world from nothing, then that just opens the door to trust God's mystery.
Three great mysteries in the Catholic Church: the Blessed Trinity, the Incarnation of the Word, and the Blessed Eucharist. Both cannot be adequately explained. If you could cut Jesus up, weigh him on a scale, do DNA testing on him, none of those things would indicate that he was the eternal Son of God. So the same thing with the Eucharist. The accidents stay the same, and you can say, that's not Jesus, but it is Jesus. By faith, it has become Jesus.
All right, let's take our last email. Max from Indiana. I have a family member who was a convert to Catholicism. She has since become a member of a Pentecostal parish that baptizes not in the name of the Trinity, but in the name of Jesus. I have heard such Pentecostal parishes as being Jesus-only Pentecostals. I'm wondering if Mr. Jones could speak of these believers and their faith.
Yes, we had many run-ins with the oneness movement. As a Pentecostal, we were Trinitarians, as most Christians are. But there were some Pentecostals that believed that what we call Sabellianism, which is that God is one person in three manifestations: God in creation, the Son in redemption, the Holy Spirit in the church. Well, that's not a new teaching. That's an old heresy in the church. And we had problems with our Pentecostal brothers that were oneness people. And we would have the classical biblical fights and shootouts over scriptures, you know, trying to prove it. But basically, it says that God is one person with three manifestations. Now, when we came to the Catholic Church, we were not asked to be baptized again, because we were baptized in the Trinitarian formula, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, which is a legal baptism. Baptism in Jesus' name is not a legal baptism. Grace is not given because it is not a legal baptism, only in the Trinitarian formula.
All right, thanks, Alex. Let's take another break, and we'll be back just a moment with some final words for the journey home. All right, welcome back to the journey home. Alex, in conclusion, I always ask a similar question. How, as you look back, how has becoming a Catholic brought you deeper and closer to Jesus Christ?
Because it has put me in contact and full union with His church. The Christian faith is about community. It's not just about me and Jesus, it's about community. And being a part of that community, and all that God has for that community is very important to me. Many people ask, why did you become Catholic? Weren't you saved? Of course, the answer is, yes, I was saved, and yes, I knew Jesus Christ. But now, this is his church. This is the body that he himself pushed off the shore onto the sea of history. And in this church is everything that is needed for salvation. Here in this church, there is the veracity that I've been looking for, the truthfulness. How can we know this is true? Well, this church has the gift of incorruptibility. It has the infallible teachings of the church. I know it is true because it is of the church. Do you know how, I'm sure as a Protestant pastor, how difficult it is to formulate some teachings and some things that difficult, we call them difficult errors in the scripture, how difficult it was to formulate them and to exegete them or to preach them. But here in the church, we have a magisterium that gives us guideposts of where we go and how far we can go in our interpretation. We have infallible guideposts that allow us to read scripture and to come away with correct understanding. So being a Catholic brings me closer to Jesus in that it brings me into full communion with his community, with his family. Now I understand that this is a big family. Now I understand that this family spans not only time, but space. There's the church in heaven that's alive, and there's the church being purified, and there's the church on the earth. I'm part of a big family. I'm in full communion with the body of Jesus Christ. So I have the fullness of faith. Not that I found Jesus, I had Jesus as a Pentecostal, but I have the fullness of faith.
Yeah. All right, Alex, another great pleasure to have you on the program.
Thank you.
Always is. And God bless you and your work there in the diocese. All right, just two things I want to remind you of at the end of our program. First of all, I thank EWTN for allowing me the opportunity to talk to you about this coming weekend. This coming weekend in Columbus, Ohio, the Coming Home Network is having their second annual conference, Deep in History, Deep in Scripture, Deep in Christ Conference. And the focus this weekend is on the early church. Speakers will be Father Paqua, Dr. Marshner, Father Connor, Father Lane, who teaches at the Pontifical Seminary, Rod Bennett, Rosalind Moss, and myself, Father Ray Ryland, will all be there. If you're interested in information about coming to the Coming Home Network Conference in Columbus, Ohio, go to chnetwork.org. That's our website. That's the Coming Home Network concert this coming weekend. Lastly, Americans, vote responsibly. You must take responsibility for this great privilege we have in this country to vote. And that means taking your faith and putting it in the votes to vote your informed conscience. God bless you. It's always a pleasure to join you on the Journey Home program. I'll see you again next week.